Dear students, today we are going to discuss the topic of kinematics. So here we study about motion, but here we don't study about causes of motion. And what is the cause of a motion? Force is the cause of motion. So that force we are not going to study about. We are just going to study about distance, displacement, average speed, average velocity, acceleration, and how different positions of a body is changing. All this we are going to study in kinematics. For example, if we take an XY graph, so if a particle is moving like this, then with respect to x-axis, y is following a certain rule, or with respect to y-axis, x is following a certain rule here. So here I can say y is a function of x in this condition. So any relation which describes the relation between y and x, that we can call it as the trajectory equation. So now we are going to study about trajectory equation. So how can we define that? The equation which describes how x and y coordinates are changing with respect to each other . This is called as trajectory equation. So we can write a trajectory equation like this: y is equals to log x. So y is equals to tan x square. So all these we can call them as trajectory equations. So how y is changing with respect to x in this condition. For example, let us take a function now. For example, if I take a function, y is equals to sine t and x is equals to cos square t. So this is how x and y values are changing. So now I want to derive a trajectory equation by using both of them. So in the trajectory equation, what should have? I should have only the relation between x and y itself. So let us see. So this x can be written as cos square t. So this cos square t is 1 minus sine square t. And here already we have the value of sine t, that is y. So we can write it as 1 minus y square. So therefore, x is equals to 1 minus y square. So therefore, I can write x plus y square is equals to 1. So this relation between x and y, we can call it as trajectory equation. Okay. So after this, we will study about distance and displacement. So the difference between distance and displacement. So let us consider a person has started from point A and he reached this point B in this condition. Then this total length traveled by the person, we call it as a distance traveled. And if you consider the shortest distance between these two points, then this length we can call it as displacement. So already we have studied in a vectors topic. So distance is a scalar quantity and displacement is a vector quantity. Then what is the reason that distance we call it as scalar quantity and displacement we call it as vector quantity here? So if you see the different directions in which the body is moving along this distance path, then here direction is like this, here direction is like this, here body is moving in this direction and here body is moving in this direction. So there is no specified direction for the total length traveled by the person. So direction is not specified in this condition. So direction keeps changing continuously, so there is no specified direction. So as there is no specified direction, we can call distance as a scalar quantity. But if you see this straight line distance, then everywhere the point is traveling, the person is traveling in the same direction, in the same specified direction. So that is the reason why we call this distance to be, or this length traveled to be, displacement. So this is how we can define distance and displacement. For example, if a person is traveling in a circular path, he has traveled from point A and he traveled to point B, let radius of the circle is R here, then here I can say, so let us consider he has traveled like this. Then here distance becomes the length of this half circle, or we can say half of the circumference, which is called as pi r, and displacement will become, displacement is this distance nothing but r plus r, which is equals to 2r. So this is how we can differentiate between distance and displacement. Now in the same condition, if person has started from point A and he traveled throughout this circle and reached point A in this condition. So then I can say distance will be equal to 2 pi r and displacement will be equal to 0 in this condition. So why displacement is 0? Because the position of the particle has not changed here. So initial position is A and final position is also A in this condition. So this is how we can differentiate the difference between distance and displacement. Now let us see one more example of this distance and displacement concept. For example, so this is point A and its position vector, I can draw it as r1 dash. This is point B, its position vector is r2 dash. Now let us consider that we have moved from A to B like this, in this path. Then this total length, we can divide this one into very small displacements like this. Then this distance or this length traveled becomes the displacement in this condition. So therefore, how can we write mathematically what is the difference between distance and displacement? So I can write distance traveled is equals to integration of modulus of dr dash. So here each of this small displacement I am considering to be dr dash. Similarly, if I want to write a displacement, then I can write it as integration of dr dash. Now let us try to understand the difference between this one and this one here. For example, if we take displacement, just integration of dr dash, so dr dash is all these small displacements we are taking, and dr dash we know it is a vector quantity. So integration represents addition of all vector quantities. So addition of all vector quantities will give vector addition. So if we take this diagram separately, so these are the different displacements which we have. And if you take this one, then this becomes the closing side of this figure, and here we are following the triangle law of addition, which already we have discussed. So in triangle law of addition, the vectors are joined head to tail, and the resultant is from head to head and tail to tail in this condition. So this shortest distance will become the vector addition of all these displacements or all these vectors, which will be in a straight line. So this length we can call it as displacement. But if you see distance, then here integration also applied, here also. Integration means addition of all dr dash values, but by considering only their magnitudes itself. So it means that we are no longer considering the vector addition, we are adding the lengths of all these small displacements, then definitely length will be in this direction instead of in this direction. So that is, we are not doing vector addition here, we are doing algebraic addition here by not considering the directions. So if you take integration of the magnitudes of all the small vectors, then it is called as a distance. And if we are doing integration of all the small displacements by considering their vector directions also, then I will get distance in this condition. So this is also how I can say the difference between distance and displacement. Now let us take an example of this one. For example, a person is at point A, then he is at point B. So this is the position vector of point A, this is the position vector of point B in this condition, and a person has traveled from here to here in this direction, then we are supposed to find out the magnitude of displacement. So magnitude of displacement is what I want in this condition. So initial position is A, final position is B, so this becomes the change in position, or I can write it as delta S dash. So if we observe this diagram carefully, then these two vectors are joined head to tail and these two vectors are joined tail to tail. So if this is R1 dash, position vector of point A, and this is R2 dash, the position vector of point B. Then by using triangular of addition, what can I write? I can write delta S dash plus R1 dash should be equal to R2 dash. It means R2 dash is the resultant of R1 dash and delta S dash, because we are following the triangle rule of addition here in this condition. So therefore, delta S dash will be equal to R2 dash minus R1 dash. That is, the displacement vector is equals to the subtraction of both the position vectors of point A and point B. But here we are supposed to find out only magnitude of this displacement. So magnitude of this displacement can be written as, so already we have studied that when vectors are subtracted, then the resultant can be written like this: square root of R1 square plus R2 square plus R minus 2R1 R2 cos theta, where theta is the angle between R1 dash and R2 dash. So this is how I can write the magnitude of displacement. So I hope you have understood what is the meaning of subtraction of vectors. Already we have done in vectors topic. Let us see this once again. So for example, this is R1 dash and this is R2 dash. Then if I construct a parallelogram, then the longest diagonal will give addition of vectors, which is R1 dash plus R2 dash. Similarly, if I take the same vectors like this, and if this is R1 dash and if this is R2 dash, and if I extend this one backwards and change the direction of this one, then this becomes minus R2 dash. So if this angle is theta, then this angle definitely becomes 180 minus theta. So that is, subtraction of vectors, angle between the vectors will become 180 minus theta. So here if I substitute in the formula R1 square plus R2 square plus 2R1 R2 cos theta, then cos 180 minus theta becomes minus cos theta. That's what exactly we are writing in this condition. So for the subtraction of two vectors, the resultant will become square root of R1 square plus R2 square minus 2R1 R2 cos theta. Okay, so this is how we can take an example of displacement. So let us see one more example of how we can understand distance and displacement concept. For example, let us consider a body has started from the origin and he is moving in a circular path. He has moved through half a circle whose radius of this circular path is R. Then from here he traveled parallel to z-axis like this by a distance of R, and from here again he traveled a distance of 2R in the direction of y-axis. So this is the total length traveled by the person, which is given. First he traveled from origin to this position, then from here to here parallel to z-axis, then here to here in the direction of y-axis or parallel to y-axis. So in this condition we are supposed to find out distance and magnitude of displacement. So these two we are supposed to find out. Then distance, we know it is the total length traveled by the person. So how can I write a distance? from here to here, distance traveled should be pi r, that is half of the circumference of this person. So I will write it as pi r, pi capital R, plus, next from here to here, he traveled a distance of r, so another r, and from here to here, he traveled a distance of 2r, so 2r. So therefore it is equals to, if I write this one in simplified form, then it becomes pi r plus 3r. So if I take r common, then it becomes 3 plus pi. So this is the total distance traveled by this person. Now, if I want to write the displacement vector of this person, then how can I write? From here, he has displaced a distance of 2r along x-axis. So this is the total length traveled by this person. But displacement is not this one. Displacement is the final position and initial position length. So final position is this point, initial position is this point. Shortest distance between both of them is r plus r, which is equals to 2r. So I can write it as 2r I cap, that is magnitude of 2r in the direction of x-axis. Next, from here, he moved along z-axis. And in the z-axis, what is the unit vector? Unit vector along z-axis is k cap. So I write it as r k cap plus, again he moved in the direction of y-axis by a displacement of 2r in this condition. So I write 2r, and unit vector along y-axis is j cap. So this is how I can write the displacement vector of this person. Then we are supposed to find out only magnitude of displacement. Then magnitude of displacement, already we know how we have calculated. Square root of 2r whole square plus r square plus 2r whole square. So therefore, S is equals to square root of 4r square plus r square plus 4r square. So this is equals to 8r square plus r square, 9r square, square root of 9r square is equals to 3r. So this will become the displacement magnitude in this condition. Okay. So now after this, we are going to study about what is meant by speed and what is meant by velocity. So now let us see. Now let us see the terms speed and velocity. So here I can write the rate at which position coordinates are changing with respect to time . This is called as velocity. And if I take the definition of speed, then I can write the rate at which length is changing with respect to time is called speed in this condition. So for example, if I draw a diagram, if I take an XY plane, so person has started from here and he is traveling throughout and reaching here. Then he is traveling in this direction and reaching this point. Then he is traveling in this direction and reaching again this point. Then if you observe carefully, for each position between A, B and C, the length traveled is continuously increasing in this condition. But the distance between 0, A, comma B and B, comma C is remaining constant. So that is, if I take speed, then I can say speed of the person is continuously changing, because speed is nothing but the change of length with respect to time. Or we can say speed can also be defined as speed is equals to distance by time. So like this also, we can define speed. So between any two intervals, the distance for the same time is continuously increasing. But if we take velocity, then the position coordinates distance is remaining constant in this condition. So therefore I can say here speed is changing continuously, but velocity is remaining constant, because in this condition this becomes the displacement between A and B. Here this becomes the displacement, displacement between O and A. In the second condition, straight line distance between A and B is the displacement, and the third condition also, straight line distance between B and C is the displacement. So if these displacements are remaining constant for the same time, then definitely I can say velocity is uniform in this condition. So this is how we can explain the difference between speed and velocity. For example, again if you take a circular path in this condition, so a person has started from point A and reached point B in this direction, and radius of this circle is R. Then here I can say speed is equals to distance by time. So here a distance between the A and B is pi R, that is half of the circumference, pi R divided by time taken is T. Similarly, if I calculate velocity, then it will be equal to displacement divided by time in this condition. And displacement is the shortest distance between two points, which is nothing but R plus R, 2R divided by T in this condition. So if we observe here, definitely the magnitudes of speed and velocity are not equal. Similarly, the person has started from point A and he reached point A again in this direction. Then I can say speed is equals to 2 pi r divided by t. But in this condition, velocity becomes 0. Why velocity becomes 0? Because initial position was A, final position is also A in this condition. So in this condition, velocity becomes 0. So this is how we can understand the difference between speed and velocity. Okay? Now, after this, we have to study about uniform speed and uniform velocity. So, uniform speed. So, uniform speed is what? If the body is covering equal distances in equal intervals of time, that it is covering equal lengths in equal time intervals. So, whatever may be the direction, that we are not concerned about. For example, a person is starting from here, traveled like this, then he traveled like this, then he traveled like this, then he traveled like this. So these are the different stopping points of this person. And if I say the length of each of them is same in the same time interval, that is the time intervals also should be same here. So length of each path is x, here also it is x, here also it is x, and here also it is x. Similarly, here time taken is t, here also time taken t, here also time taken t, here also time taken t. Then definitely I can say the body is traveling with uniform speed. That is equal lengths traveled in equal time intervals. Similarly, if I study about uniform velocity, then the condition which we discussed previously, that is it should cover equal displacements in equal intervals of time. So for example, person is traveling like this. So he traveled like this, then he traveled like this, then he traveled like this. But the time taken from here to here is t, time taken from here to here is also t, time taken from here to here is also t. Then can I say this motion is uniform or not, or it is traveling with uniform velocity or not? So definitely I can say the body is traveling with uniform velocity. How can I say that it is traveling with uniform velocity? First condition is time intervals are same. And second condition is the position vector's distance is also equal. That is the distance between position vectors is also same. Or I can say the displacement between the adjacent points or the successive points is also equal in this condition. So when displacements are equal and time intervals are equal, then definitely I can say body is traveling with uniform velocity. So this is how we can explain the difference between uniform speed and uniform velocity. Now let us see average speed and average velocity concept. So how can I define average velocity? So average velocity can be defined as total displacement divided by total time. Okay. So for example, if I draw a graph between displacement and time in this condition. So a person has traveled like this and returned here. So he is moving along x-axis. That is, x-axis length is changing with respect to time. And after some time, again he returned to the same position. So in this condition, total displacement, I can say it is equal to zero. If total displacement is zero, then I can say in this condition, the average velocity will become zero because body has not displaced. But it doesn't mean that the body has not traveled. Body has definitely traveled. So it moved through a distance of some x, and then frame again it returned back to the same position. Then I can say displacement is zero. Same graph I can draw like this. Person has traveled from here to here, position A to position B. Then again he returned back from B to A. So the position of particle A is, this particle is not changing. But definitely the particle has traveled. But it doesn't mean that every time displacement must exist. So in a closed path, displacement always becomes zero. So I can say in this condition, the average velocity becomes zero in this condition. So average velocity always doesn't give an idea about total motion of the body. That is the reason why we have considered instantaneous velocities also. Instantaneous velocities means velocities at a particular instant of time, that is when time is, when it is zero, time interval when it is almost equal to zero, at that instant what is the velocity? That we call it as instantaneous velocity. So this is how we can understand. Similarly, if I draw one more graph between velocity and time here. So velocity and like this. This represents that velocity of the body is continuously increasing and velocity of the body is continuously decreasing in this condition. So so now we will study about average speed. So how can I define this one? Average speed is equals to total distance traveled divided by total time taken. This is called as average speed. So this can also, I can write it as S1 plus S2 plus S3 plus dash 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 divided by T1 plus T2 plus T3 dash dash. This is how I can write. So for example, if I take for three intervals of average speed, then I can write S1 plus S2 plus S3 divided by T1 plus T2 plus T3. So we know displacement is equals to velocity into time. So I can write V1 T1 plus V2 T2 plus V3 T3 divided by T1 plus T2 plus T3. So this is one more equation I can write in terms of average speed here. So here I can take one more condition. Condition is, if time intervals are equal, T1 is equals to T2 is equals to T3 is equal to T here. Then how can I write? I can write V average speed is equals to V1 plus V2 plus V3 divided by T plus T plus 3T, and T in the numerator and T in the denominator have cancelled. So this is the result I will get. So V1 plus V2 plus V3 divided by 3. Similarly, if I take only for two intervals, then V average can be written as V1 plus V2 divided by 2. So this is a very simple relation which explains the average speed when body is traveling with uniform time intervals. Time interval same means from position to position B, he has taken a time of 10 minutes. From B to C also a time of 10 minutes. From C to D also a time of 10 minutes, then we can use this relation. Now similarly, we can see about one more type of relation in this one. So average speed is equals to S1 plus S2 plus S3 divided by T1 plus T2 plus T3. So average velocity or average speed can be written as S1 plus S2 plus S3 divided by time can be written as displacement by velocity. So S1 by V1 plus S2 by V2 plus S3 divided by V3. Now this is one more equation for average speed of a body, and this equation is only in terms of displacement and velocity. Now here also, if I take a condition, case, what is that one? If S1 is equals to S2 is equals to S3 is equals to S, that is the displacements are equal. So question can be given like this: I have traveled from here to Madras and Madras to again to this place. Then what is the average velocity? So in this condition, displacements are equal. The distance traveled are equal in this condition. So therefore I can write, so V average is equals to here, S plus S plus S will become 3S divided by 1 by V1 plus 1 by V2 plus 1 by V3 multiplied by S. So this S and this S gets cancelled. So average velocity or average speed is equals to 3 by 1 by V1 plus 1 by V2 plus 1 by V3. This is how I can write down. Similarly, if I take only for two intervals, I can write average speed is equals to 2V1 V2 divided by V1 plus V2 by using the same relation. So this is some information on average speed and average velocity. So now we will study about average velocity. So how can we define average velocity? Total displacement. This is velocity, no? So total displacement divided by total time. Or I can write it as X2 minus X1 divided by T2 minus T1. I can write like this. Clear? So same equation, if I want to write in the form of vectors. Vectors form lo rayalante? So I can write is equals to, not a ds, we are not studying about instantaneous velocity, we are studying about only average velocity here. So x2 square, x2 dash minus x1 dash divided by t2 minus t1. This is the relation. Are you able to understand? So one problem with average velocity is it doesn't give complete idea of about motion in some conditions. So let us see what is that condition. So the graph always doesn't give complete information about motion of a body. So we study one more condition, which is called instantaneous velocity. Instantaneous velocity. What is meant by instantaneous velocity? Velocity at any one particular instant is called as instantaneous velocity. Or in the form of equation, how can I write that one? Okay. Oh my God. In the form of equation, I can write it as V instantaneous is equals to limit delta t tends to 0. And I can write this is ds divided by dt. Or delta s divided by delta t. I can write like this, no? Okay. Limit delta tends to 0 means delta t value is very, very, very small. So small that it is almost equal to 0. Are you able to understand? So that is called as limit delta t tends to 0. Are you able to understand, ma? So if delta t is very small, then it means definitely it is instantaneous velocity. Velocity at a particular instant. Okay? So same equation, if I want to write in the form of vectors, then how can I write? I can write it as delta here, limit when it tends to 0, then delta converts into d. Differential means very, very small. Clear, ma? So ds dash divided by dt. I can write like this. Okay. then d by dt of displacement vector I can write like this, no? X I cap plus y j cap plus z k cap. Can I write like this? This is displacement vector only, no? So again, instantaneous velocity, how can I write? I can write it as dx by dt I cap plus dy by dt j cap plus dz by dt k cap. I can write like this. Clear? Then this dx by dt, how can I write it? I can write it as v instantaneous is equals to vx I cap plus vy j cap plus vz k cap. Clear? So it means that total instantaneous velocity is equals to the sum of, or the vector sum of, instantaneous velocities along all the three axes. That is the meaning of this equation. Clear? Similarly, if I want magnitude of this equation, then what I have to do?
Square root of
Vx square plus Vy square plus Vz square. This is the study first of all. Average acceleration. Okay. So how can I write equation for average acceleration? A average is equals to V2 minus V1 divided by T2 minus T1. This is how I can write. So total change in velocity divided by total change in time. Same equation if I want to write in the form of vectors. Then? So average is equals to V2 dash minus V1 dash divided by T2 minus T1. This is how I can write in the form of vectors. Clear? So let us have a small discussion on V2 dash minus V1 dash. Clear, ma? So what is the meaning of V1 dash here?
Initial
velocity. V2 dash?
Final
velocity. Okay, let us see. So for example, let us consider a body is moving like this. Okay? So here it is having a velocity of V1 dash. Here it is having a velocity of V2 dash. Then how to represent these directions, can you say? Body is moving along this path. Clear? Here velocity is V1. Here velocity is V2. No. How to represent this vector pictorically? How? To this line, if I draw a tangent, that becomes the direction of V1 dash, no? This is the direction. Similarly, here also if I draw a tangent, that becomes the direction of V2 dash. Okay? No. Here what we are representing, only direction. Clear? When body is here, this is the direction of the body. When body is here, this is the direction of this body. Clear? Now if you draw both of them like this, so this becomes my V1 dash and this is my V2 dash. So what is the change in velocity of the body? Velocity has changed from V1 to V2, no? So it means that this will be my change in velocity delta V dash. Clear, ma? So velocity has changed from V1 to V2. Now here a triangle is formed, and do you observe that it is following triangle rule of addition? Triangle rule it is following, no? No, here. Here two tails are joined. Here two heads are joined, so this becomes the resultant. Correct, no? So therefore, V2 dash, how can I write? I can write it is equals to V1 dash plus delta V dash. These two vectors are added and this is the result which I am getting. Clear, ma? So therefore, delta V dash, what can I get? V2 dash minus V1 dash. So what is the most important point which we have understood here? Change in velocity is always equals to final velocity minus initial velocity. This point we should remember. Clear? So make a note of that one. So therefore I can write change in velocity is equals to final velocity minus initial velocity. Clear? So with the help of position vectors, we have done this problem. Clear, ma? Okay. Now let us see what is meant by instantaneous acceleration. Again, what is meant by instantaneous acceleration?
Acceleration
at a particular instant, that is when time tends to zero. Clear? So how can I write V instantaneous is equals to limit delta t tends to zero delta V dash divided by delta t. This can also be written as dV dash divided by dt. Clear? So again, if I want to write in the form of components, then how can I write d by dt of vx I cap plus vy j cap plus vz k cap. So therefore, instantaneous acceleration is equals to ax I cap plus ay j cap plus az k cap. So, and if similarly, if I want magnitude of this instantaneous acceleration, so square root of ax square plus ay square plus az square. This is my values. Clear now up to here? Very easy. Okay. Now let us see one more equation of this acceleration. Very, very, very important equation. Clear? Let us see. So we know A is equals to dV divided by dt, no? Change in velocity divided by change in time. Same equation, dV by dt multiplied by dx, will anything change? Nothing will change. So dx and dx, they will get cancelled. Now I will write this one as dx by dt into dv divided by dx. Then what is dx by dt? Displacement by time? Velocity. So therefore, A acceleration is v dv divided by dx. So this is another very important equation for acceleration. So in this condition, can you say what is meant by V? What type of velocity? Initial velocity. Here V represents initial velocity. Clear? Because dV is continuously changing with respect to x, no? So as x value is changing, V value is also changing. So here V should represent the initial velocity of this body. Clear?
2V's.
V dV divided by dx. This is a change in V. This is initial velocity. Clear?
V2 minus V1 and
V1. So this is initial velocity. This is?
Change.
How velocity is changing with respect to x value. X means displacement. So along as displacement is changing, velocity also changes. That is nothing but acceleration, no? So this is another equation of acceleration. So what is the first equation we have? A is equals to dV divided by dt. And second equation is this one. So can you say in which condition I can use this one and in which condition I can use this one? Can you say?
Sir, this one, they gave velocity with respect to distance.
Very good. This one?
Velocity with respect to time.
Time, that's all. Clear? For example, velocity is given like this. 3x square plus 2x plus 6. Then we have to use this relation. Because here velocity is dependent on time. X value, displacement. Similarly, if velocity is given as 2t square plus 6t plus 7. then here velocity is dependent on time. Then we have to use this relation. That is the difference. Clear, ma? Okay. So make a note of this one. Completed, no? Equations of motion. So, equations of motion. So we know there are basically three equations of motion. No? What are they? V is equals to u plus at. S is equals to ut plus half at square. Next, v square minus u square is equals to 2as. And one more equation. Sn is equals to u plus a into n minus 1 by 2. These are the equations. Clear? And what is this Sn here? Displacement of the body in one particular second, only 1 second, and whatever may be that second. Clear? And one more important application of these equations of motion is, if you take one direction to be positive, then other direction must be taken to be negative. Can you say what is the reason why we have to do like this? Think. Because velocity, final velocity, initial velocity, acceleration, displacement, all of them are vectors. All of them are vectors, no? So definitely we have to consider the direction. So one direction, if I take positive, another direction definitely I have to take to be negative. Clear, ma? And can you say what is the difference between all these equations and displacement is equals to velocity into time? This is also equation for motion, no? We have this equation also, displacement is equals to velocity into time. We have these three equations also. Then what is the difference? When we use this condition, when we use these three conditions. Accelerated motion. And this is uniform motion. Here there is no term called A here. But in all these equations, we have the term A. Clear? Okay. Similarly, we can see linear vertical motion. Okay. So what is linear vertical motion? Vertical motion means moving up and down. That's all, no? So acceleration due to gravity is always acting downwards. With respect to that acceleration, if body is in movement, then that type of motion we call it as linear vertical motion. Clear? So when a body is either with feet is moving upwards or coming down, then this is an example of linear vertical motion. Then here also we have particular conditions of directions. So what are the conditions here? For example, this is the reference point which I am taking. Clear, ma? This point is the reference. So if velocity is in upwards direction, then that velocity I will take it as positive. Clear? Similarly, displacement is also in upwards direction, then that also I will take to be positive. And if body is coming down with a certain velocity, that velocity I will take to be negative. And with respect to this point, if body is downwards, then that displacement I call it as negative. Clear, ma? These are the conditions. So whatever velocity or displacement, when it is above this one, our velocity direction is above and displacement is above this reference, then we call them as positive. Similarly, these values we call them as negative. Then what about acceleration due to gravity?
Constant.
Minus g means always it is acting downwards towards the center of the earth. Clear, ma? So acceleration is always minus g. It means it is always acting downwards. Okay? So a value always we have take minus g in the case of vertical upward motion or linear vertical motion. Have you understood? Okay. So, write down a small question on this one. Come on. A person is traveling half of the distance. A person is traveling half of the distance with a velocity V naught. And in the next half distance, for half time, he is traveling with a velocity V1. And next half time with a velocity V2. Clear, ma? Find out the total average velocity of this person. Find out the total average velocity of this person. Clear? So try for 2 minutes, then we will see this problem. So, this is the given data, no? So, this is the total distance traveled by the person. I can consider like this. Then half of the distance, he is traveling with a velocity V0. And in the next half of the distance, for half time with a velocity V1, and next half time with a velocity V2. Then total average velocity I want to calculate. Clear? So if displacements are equal, then I have a equation for average velocity, you know, 2V1 V2 divided by V1 plus V2. Understand? But the problem is here again two velocities are there. Then what about this one? For this motion, times are equal, no? So first we calculate average velocity for second half of the motion. Okay? So how can I write? For second half motion, average velocity is equals to, how can I write when times are equal? V1 plus V2 divided by 2. Already we have written these equations in the notes, no, in yesterday's class. Clear? So V1 plus V2 by 2, values are V1 plus V2 by 2. So this is the average velocity for second half of the distance. So instead of this total diagram, now I can draw a single diagram, no? So for displacement S by 2, here velocity is V0, here velocity is V1 plus V2 divided by 2. Clear? Now we have this velocity and this velocity. Now can't I find out average velocity when displacements are equal? What is the relation? V average velocity is equals to 2V1 V2 divided by V1 plus V2. So substitute the values and try to get the answer. Okay? Come on. So here V1 is V0, V2 is V1 plus V2 by 2. Clear? Come on. Try to write without seeing. that answer you should get. These two gets cancelled, but here there is one more 2, no? So 2v0 plus v1 plus v2 by 2. This 2 goes to the numerator. Clear? Okay. So this is my answer. So let us see some more interesting questions. Write down the question. If velocity of a particle is given by, if velocity of a particle is given by v is equal to 3t square plus 2 meters per second, find the displacement covered by the particle from t is equals to 1 to t is equal to 2 seconds. Particle from t is equals to 1 to t is equal to 2 seconds. Clear? Come on. Try to do this question. Displacement we have to find out. No need of any acceleration here. So, velocity is equals to 3t square plus 2 meters per second. So, I want a displacement from a time of t is equals to 1 to t is equals to 2 seconds. This is the question. Okay. Dx square by dt square for acceleration, no? But here given equation is only velocity. Okay. So, do you understand what I have written here? So, dx by dt is nothing but velocity. So, again dv by dt is called acceleration. So, displacement if I differentiate with respect to time, I will get velocity. Velocity, if I differentiate with respect to time, I will get acceleration. So integration is exactly opposite method of differentiation, no? So if I integrate with respect to time, then I should get velocity. And velocity, if I integrate with respect to time, I should get displacement. Okay, so by using this technique, we are supposed to solve this problem. Okay, come on, try to do. Nine, let us. I too don't know what is the answer. So, t cube by 3, no? So, t cube plus 2t and limits are applied from 1 to 2. So, s is equals to 2t 2 cube plus 4 minus t 1 cube is 1 minus 1 plus 2. So 8 plus 4, 12 minus 3 is equals to 9. 9 meters is our answer. Clear, Numa? That's a very simple question. Okay? So, can you say what is meant by this 1 and 2?
Limits
of integration, that is a time. Here we are differentiating, integrating with respect to time, no? So time variables we have to substitute there. Time variables are from 1 to 2. Clear, Numa? So this is how we integrate. Okay. Complete number, write down the next one. A body moves with a velocity. A body moves with a velocity. V is equals to 2t plus 4 meters per second. 2t plus 4 meters per second. Find the average velocity of the body. Find the average velocity of the body from t is equals to 1 second to t is equal to 2 seconds. Okay? At t is equals to 0, body starts from origin. At t is equals to 0, body starts from origin. That is the question. 7 meters per second. 7 is the answer. So v is equals to 2t plus 4 meters per second. So I want to calculate average velocity from time intervals 1 second to 2 second. So initially at t is equals to 0, body is at origin. Okay, let us. Minus 5 is 7. Therefore, V average is equals to x2 minus x1 divided by t2 minus t1. X2 minus x1 is 7 divided by 1 is 7 meters per second. That is our answer. First try to understand what we have done. Clear? Ide kada, this is the equation for average velocity. So x2 minus x1 by t2 minus t1. And if I integrate the given function, definitely I can get x2 minus x1. And limits are applied from initial displacement to final displacement. Clear? Then I got the answer. That's all. Okay? completed ma? Now, this is, see ma, here, what is v is equals to 2t plus 4? Velocity is changing with respect to time, no? So at every instant of time, velocity is changing. So definitely we have to take the equation of instantaneous velocity only. Understand? But if you integrate this one, what I will get? I will get displacement positions. Clear? And then again in substituting that average velocity, we have to get the answer. Clear? So that is why I want to understand you the method in which we have done carefully. Clear? Okay. I hope you have understood. Clear? So if you differentiate this one, dx means it should have a limit of integration, no? And that limit will be x1 and x2. X1, x2 indicates that x1 is my initial position, x2 is my final position. So instantaneous, from instantaneous acceleration velocity, I got average velocity relations. Clear? That's what we are doing. Okay. Write down the next question. If a car accelerates with acceleration, with respect to equation, A is equals to, six x square plus two x plus five. Find velocity of particle when it is at x is equal to 3 meters. Given that, initially it starts from, x is equal to 1, with velocity 2 meters per second. Clear ma? Very, very carefully you should think about this question. Otherwise you will not get this question. Think. Yes, that relation we have to use. Because acceleration is dependent on x value, no? So by using that relation only, we have to get the answer, okay? Come on. A is equals to 6x square plus 2x plus 5. So velocity I am supposed to find out. X is equal to 3 meter. Velocity at x is equal to 3 meter. So initially it starts from x is equal to 1 with a velocity 2 meters per second. Clear? Come on. let us say root 124, huh? No, 124 you said, no, think again. So b square by 2 minus 2 square by 2 is 2 is equals to 6x cube plus 2x square plus 5x, and limits are applied from 1 to 3. So v square by 2 minus 2 is equals to, then substitute and see what are the values we get here. 6 into 3 cube plus 2 into 3 square plus 5 into 3 minus 6 into 1 cube plus 2 plus 5. So therefore v square by 2 minus 2 is equals to, solve this and see what is the equation you will get. Six into, solve this one. Where?
X cube by 3, sir.
Oh, x cube by 3 we are getting, no?
And
yes.
X square by 2.
Sorry. Then this is okay. Then here what we get? 2. Here we get? X square. That's all, no?
Yes, sir.
Then? Then here what I will get? 2 into 1 plus 1 plus 5. 80 we are getting, 80. Okay, 80. Then v square is equals to 82. No, 82 is not the answer. Let us see the answer of this one. Answer is v square 144 we should get, ma. So that is 12 meters per second should be our answer. So check and see what we will getting.
Sir, 144, this is 70, sir, not 80.
70, no?
Yes,
yes, then it is correct. So then v square is equals to how much? 72 by 2. So v square is equals to 1, for v value is 12 meters per second. That is the answer. Okay? Okay. Clear, Namma, how we have done? So we are using this relation. A is equals to v dv by dx. Clear? Next, have you understood how we have applied these limits here? So what is meant by 2 and v?
Sir, upper, lower limit is 2 and upper limit is v.
Why v?
At the final velocity.
Because here we don't know what is the velocity. Clear, ma? But initially, we know the velocity is already given. It is at x is equals to 1, it is equal to 2 meters per second. Clear? But at x is equal to 3, we doesn't know what is the velocity. So limits should be 2 and v here. And here, x values are changing from 1 to 3. So here limits of integration will be 1 and 3. Okay? That's all. This is our question. So let us see one more question. Write down this question. Completed, ma? A car is moving at 20 meters per second. Car is moving at 20 meters per second. The driver applies the brakes the driver applies the brakes, which causes a retardation of 4 meters per second square. Which causes a retardation of 4 meters per second square. Find the distance traveled by the car. Find the distance traveled by the car before it stops. The reaction time of driver is, the reaction time of driver is 0.4 seconds. Clear, ma?
Reaction time
of the driver is 0.4 seconds. So very easy question. I hope you can do it. So velocity is 20 meters per second. Retardation is 4 meters per second square. Distance traveled I have to calculate. Reaction time is equal to 0.4 seconds. Okay?
Sir, 4.8 meters. After 4.8 meters.
No. Answer is 58 meters.
Yes, sir. 58
meters. Oh, that is the answer. Very good. 58 meters should be the answer. Got it? Okay. So, v square minus u square is 2as. Finally, it is stopping, no? So, final velocity is 0. Initial velocity, 20 square is equals to 2 into acceleration is minus 4. Displacement, I don't know. So, minus minus gets cancelled. So, 400 is equals to 8 into s. So, s is equals to 400 divided by 8, which is equals to 50 meters. Okay. But there is concept of but there is no time, no, here. Time is not there.
Reaction time.
Time is not there, no?
Reaction time.
Reaction time is different. What is meant by reaction time? So, after he feels to apply the brakes, he is taking a time of 0.4 seconds to apply the brakes. That is the meaning of reaction time. Clear? It means that in this time also, the car will move a distance of uniform, it will move with the uniform speed, no? Because until 0.4 seconds, he did not apply the brakes. So car is traveling with the same velocity of 20. So therefore, in this reaction time, what is the displacement traveled? Velocity into time. Why we are using this relation?
Sir, you gave us retardation as 4 meters per second.
Second square. No, per second square. Clear, ma? So, can you say why we are using this relation here? Displacement is equals to velocity into time for the concept of reaction time. No. Why we have used v square minus u square is 2as here? Why we are using s is equals to v into t here?
Sir, here acceleration is
where? Here there is no application of any brakes here. It is traveling with uniform velocity. Clear? So, velocity is 20. Reaction time is 0.4, so 4 2s are 8 meters per second. It means that after traveling a distance of 8 meters per second, then he applied the brakes. So therefore, total distance before stopping is how much? Total distance before stopping should be equal to 50 plus 8 is, same. 8 meters only, 8 meters, so total displacement is 58 meters. Clear? That's all. Very easy question, no? Now I will give you a small logical question. write down the next one. A particle starts with initial speed of. A particle starts with initial speed of 17 meters per second and retards at 2 meters per second square. Retards at 2 meters per second square. Find the distance traveled by the particle. Find the distance traveled by the particle in 9th second of motion. In 9th second of motion. Okay, ma? So just we will do this problem and we stop for today. 9th second of motion. That is in 9th second, how much distance here? Distance I want to calculate, don't be confused. I don't want displacement here, I want distance. Come on. So, what is the data?
Initial speed
is 17. Retardation is 2 meters per second square. So distance traveled, distance I want to calculate in 9th second. Come on, try for 2 minutes is not there, 1 minute is there. Try for 1 minute. No. No. Small logic is there. Just you should understand that logic, that's all. Answer is 0.5 meters. This is the answer, 0.5 meter. How?
Initial velocity is 17.
Yes, definitely.
You took there 0.
Where? Yes, there I took 0 only. See, my here, let us see. If body travels with this accelerate, this velocity and this much of acceleration, it will stop after how much time? So retardation means its velocity continuously becomes zero and it will stop, no? So if I calculate that time taken, how much I got? 8.5. It means that after 8.5 seconds, it is stopping. But is acceleration, is it becoming zero? No, it means that what? Body starts to move in opposite direction, but with the same acceleration. But when it has stopped, then what is its initial velocity?
Zero,
no? So are you able to understand what I am saying? For first it started from here, after time is equals to 8.5 seconds, it stopped here, its velocity became zero. Clear? But here after off, again acceleration is acting in opposite direction, no? So it is returning back now in the same direction and in the same path also. So here velocity is how much? Final velocity for this motion is zero. For this motion, this becomes the initial velocity. That's all, no? So up to here it is 8.5. But I want distance traveled in a ninth second, no? So 8.5 to ninth second, how much time is present? Half second. Half second, no? Up to here 8.5. From here onwards again, another 0.5 distance I want to calculate. And that is the distance exactly I have calculated. Distance traveled in half second. So that is how much? 0.25. But can you say why I have added 0.25 plus 0.25 is 0.5? I have calculated only for half second, no? So previous half second also it should have traveled the same distance because acceleration is remaining same in this condition. Are you able to understand? So if this distance is how much? 0.25, then this distance is also 0.25. So total distance traveled in the ninth second will be 0.25 plus 0.25, that is 0.5. Have you understood, ma? So, in the same question, if he asks you to find out a displacement, then what is my answer? Distance is, you got
0.5. No,
not, I am asking only displacement in ninth second will be how much?
Zero.
Why zero?
Because
from 8.5, from 8 to 8.5, this is 8 to 8.5, no? From 8 to 8.5, body is moving in this direction. From 8.5 to 9, it is moving in opposite direction. And distances are also same. So they get cancelled with each other. So displacement in 9th second will be
zero.
That is our answer. Have you understood, ma? So whenever this type of questions are given, first we have to calculate this time. Time after which the body will stop. Stop. That is when its velocity will become
zero.
Clear, no? Okay. So tomorrow we will do some more interesting questions.